shed for the blood.
Amen.
Amen. I praise him for shedding the blood.
Yes, Lord.
You can be seated. The Lord bless you today in Jesus' name. Amen. Welcome to the house of the Lord. God is good to us today. Amen. We've come to worship him in spirit and in truth. Amen.
Yes.
And God is well able to come and supply every need that is here tonight. Praise God. If you have something that you need God to work on, he's well able to do it while we are worshiping him. Amen. And I'm thankful for the promises of God. Could we put our hands together? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Shout. Glory to the Lord. Praise the Lord. Together tonight, and let's believe that the Lord has something in store for us today. Amen. Let's sing and worship.
Yes.
Quillen today, and she's much better and expected to go home tomorrow. Also, there's this young man by the name of Max, and I'm not sure of his last name, but he's been talking to us and seemed to be interested in church. And in fact, I got a call and was kind of expecting him to be here tonight. But God knows this gentleman, amen, and those that was with us, Mr. and Mrs. Lynn was here Sunday night, as well as Donna and Jonathan, her grandson. Let's remember them. Amen. God is good to us. If you have a need, amen, could you raise your hand? God's able to perform a miracle for you. In the name of Jesus, shall we pray together? In the name of our God, I bless you today. I praise you. You are an awesome God. I thank you for your victory that you've given us through the power of the Holy Ghost. Lord, we have victory in Christ our Lord. Oh, God, I praise you, God. Lord, you're more than able to raise the sick from the bed of affliction. You're able to rebuke the spirit of infirmity. We thank you, Jesus, for mercy, God. We praise you today. What an awesome God we serve. My God, I praise you today. I bless you, Lord. Thank God, I praise you, God. I praise you, God. What a great God. What a great God. Oh, we worship you. We praise you, God.
Yes.
My God, Lord, send your angel, Lord. My God, heal. By your stripes, you purchased our healing. We thank you, God, for mercy. We praise your name, Lord. Hallelujah. Let's clap our hands and thank the Lord for taking care of his needs. Come on, let's praise him. We bless you today, God. We bless you today. Amen. You can be seated. Prepare to give tonight. Amen. In our offering, Brother Owens, Brother Barnes, would you come? Amen. Don't forget our Christmas offering that we are collecting here in this container by the piano. Amen. We want to bless somebody, some family. Amen. So much for you. Thank you so much for your giving. Amen. We are far exceeding our goal for this year. Amen. So, amen. It won't surprise me if we don't, amen, get close to that $20,000 mark. Amen, because of your giving. And thank you so much for that. Amen. Let's sing and worship the Lord. We sing.
Such a
Service, and we appreciate them coming and taking time off to be with us. And she has had to go back to Georgia for a few days this week, and so we miss her, but we're thankful for him to come. Amen. We've known these folks for a mighty long time. Amen. And if you don't say any bad things about me when I close tonight, I won't say no bad things about you. Praise God. He was about 5 years old when I first met him. Amen, maybe. Praise God. And he probably remembers more about me than I remember about him. Praise God. Well, God bless you today. Amen. Could you just put your hands together? Welcome to the world.
God's good, isn't he?
Amen.
I guess I'm a little out of my element without my wife here tonight. It's been a long time since I preached without her here. So if I go long tonight, just know it's because she's not here. Because when we go places and I start going long, she starts doing this right here. That means wrap it up. And so that's how I always know to keep it under about 30, 35 minutes. So if I go over that, it's just because she's not here. Sister Allen asked me before I came up, she's like, do you sing or do anything? I said, I don't do anything. You know, the only thing I know how to do is preach, and I'm not very good at that. So I'm just going to give it my best shot tonight. But I'm actually a musician, so I will say that. I play bass. I've played bass for probably 15 years, but I'm not a singer. Everybody in my family can sing. I don't know why I can't sing. If you think it would be hereditary, it's not. I don't understand. But I'm so glad to be with each and every one of you tonight. I give honor to your pastor and to your pastor's wife, brother and sister Allen, dear friends of mine. I'm so happy and so privileged to be with you tonight. If you have your Bibles, would like to turn me to the book of 2 Samuel, chapter 15. I give honor also to my wife, who's not with us tonight. She's had to go home for a doctor's appointment. We're expecting our first child in November, and so we are super excited. Yeah, I tell people, we're having a little girl. I told we was at Brother Sears on Sunday, and I told him, I said, listen, I'll be straight with you if you be straight with me. I said, but I prayed for a little boy, and God gave me a little girl. So if you come and want me to lay hands and pray for you, I don't know what's going to happen. I'll just be honest with you. Who knows? Only God knows. But 2 Samuel chapter 15, verse 15, says, and the king's servant said unto the king, behold, thy servants are ready to do whatsoever my lord the king shall appoint. And the king went forth, and all his household after him. And the king left 10 women, which were concubines, to keep the house. And the king went forth, and all his people after him, and tarried in a place that was far off. Now, if you want to flip over probably two pages to chapter 20 and verse 3, it says, and David came to his house at Jerusalem, and the king took the 10 women, his concubines, whom he had left to keep the house, and put them inward, and fed them, but went not in unto them. And so they were shut up unto the day of their death, living in widowhood. Tonight, for just a little bit, I want to talk about that thought, living in widowhood. Living in widowhood. If it's all right, if you could sit your Bibles down and lift your hands one more time and just pray for God's anointing, for God to speak to us tonight. God, we're so thankful, Lord, for your spirit that we've already felt so evident in this place, God. God, I thank you for your anointing. God, I pray right now that you would anoint me as I deliver your word, Lord. God, I pray that you would give us a fresh word tonight, Lord. That you would give us something to take home. God, help us to take your word, to apply it to our lives. God, I don't want to leave the same way I came in, God. I want to leave different. I want to leave changed. I want to leave filled with your spirit tonight, Lord. God, we will do this. We will give you the praise, the glory, and honor, Jesus. In the precious name of Jesus. Before the opening text we just read, we read that Absalom, he won the hearts of the people. Yeah. And it said that he went and he stood in the gate of the city. And everybody that came in to speak to David, He would stand there and he would stop him and say, well, David, King David doesn't have time for you. I'll handle your situation. And so he would give them counseling or guidance. And then he would tell them before they left, you know, if I was king, you would never have to worry about this problem. I would always have time for you. And he began doing this David, without David knowing. And it apparently went on for some time.
Yes, sir.
And David never realized this was happening until the day that Absalom went away. And he went to get his army to come back to Jerusalem. And we read here that the servants, they come running to David. They said, David, Absalom's won the heart of the people.
Come on now.
They're coming. He is on his way. And we have to run. We have to get out of town. And so David, he tells everybody. He says, get everybody we got. Tell them we're leaving. Pack up the house. Pack up all my belongings. Tell my wives, my concubines, everybody that we're leaving town. But then he says, well, I have to leave somebody. Somebody has to stay.
Come on now.
And so he chooses 10 concubines. He brings them forth and he says that he has to leave them to keep the house. He said, I need you to stay and keep the house because we have to flee. We have to get out of here. But I can't leave my house unattended. All right. And so they say, okay, we'll stay. And so between chapter 15 and chapter 20, like I said, chapter 20, verse 3, read, he comes, he takes these 10 concubines. They're still doing exactly what he said to. They're still keeping the house. They're still there. But he comes in, he feeds them, and he imprisons them in widowhood for the rest of their life. Now, when I read that, it's kind of weird. You think, wait a minute. He left them there to keep the house, and now all of a sudden, he's imprisoning them. He's taking them in, and he's locking them away for the rest of their lives. Well, you see, something happened in between chapter 15 and chapter 20. 2 Samuel 16, verse 20 says, "Then Absalom to Ahithophel said, 'Give counsel among you what we shall do.' And Ahithophel said to Absalom, 'Go in and tell thy father's concubines, which he had left to keep the house, and all Israel shall hear that thou art abhorred of thy father. Then shall the hands of all that are with thee be strong.' So they spread Absalom a tent upon the top of the house, and Absalom went in unto his father's concubines in the sight of all Israel." Absalom came in. He came and he took the house, and the concubines were there. First, he acted like they weren't even there, and he got some terrible advice from his hand, from his friend Ahithophel, who told him to go and to take his father's concubines. He says, "Go in unto them, take them onto a roof, so that everybody will know that you are king." This wasn't what it was all about—a power play. It was all about trying to build himself up to make him be king, let the people know that he was king and that he was in charge. You know, and I've read this story many times, but I've never stopped to consider one thing. And so if it's all right, just for a brief moment, let's take a look at this whole story from the point of view of the concubines.
Yes.
Let's think how they felt with all this playing out. Because you see, these women were once little girls. They were just little girls with big dreams, if you will, that probably dreamed of being princesses, living in castles, wearing fancy clothes. These were the dreams of my wife. And she married a chicken farmer and lives in a camper. So that's a far cry from that. You know, but these little girls, they had dreams. And they said, you know, this is what I want to be. This is where I want to go. And these girls, they grew up. And as they grew into beautiful young women. Women so beautiful that even the king himself said, "Wow, these girls, they've gotten pretty. You know, I've never noticed them before." To one day, David sent messengers to bring him to the castle that says, "The king wants you to come live with him." All of a sudden, their dreams came true. All of a sudden, they get to live in the castle. They get to wear the finest of clothes, sit at the king's table. You know, everything that a girl could wish for, everything that anybody could wish for. They were on top of the world. Everything was handed to them. It was like a fairy tale. They had favor with the king. They had the best of the best.
Sure.
And then that relationship with David blossomed into something beautiful. You see, over time, David realized that these 10 women were not only fair to look upon, but they were trustworthy. That they were loyal to David. He knew that they respected and they took care of the things of his house.
All right.
He could trust them. And they spent many years with David, and they saw him in his highs, they saw him in his lows, they saw after victories and after defeats.
Yes.
You know, these women weren't always the first ones chosen, but they were always loyal to David. Mm-hmm. They were always there for David. And then we come to the day that we read about in 2 Samuel 15. Absalom is coming. Yeah. David tells everybody to pack up. I can just see these concubines are going and they're packing, getting all their belongings. They're making sure they got everything because we have to get out of here. We have to flee. When a messenger comes to him and says, "David wants to see you." And I have to believe that their first thoughts were that David, the king, he wants to make sure that we're going to be with him.
Yes.
He's going to make sure that we're going to be in his caravan, that we're taken care of because we've always been loyal to David. David, he does care about us. He's going to make sure that we get out of here first, even if nobody else makes it out. And he brings them before. And they stand there, and David looks at him, and he says, "I have to leave somebody, and I've chosen you. I've chosen you to stay behind." At first, you just have to imagine these women were just like, what? Wait a minute. I thought we were leaving.
Sure.
But David said, "I have to have somebody trustworthy. I have to have somebody loyal.
Yeah.
I have to have somebody that I know when the enemy comes into this house, they're not going to flip-flop.
Come on now.
They're not going to turn." He said, I can't leave servants. Right. Servants that can be easily influenced by money. He said, I can't just leave anybody to keep my house. And so he told these 10 women, and they said, okay. And they stayed. Could you just imagine when David and everything that they care about, everything that they love, everything that's been a part of their life for so long, is just riding off and leaving them behind. They stood there on the porch and they watched the love of their life, David, and everything they cared about, ride off into the distance.
Yes.
They went in, they began to keep the house. They began to sweep and just clean up from everybody that had just left. And And it isn't long before Absalom and his whole army comes in. They come into the house and they make themselves right at home. And as far as we know, he just kind of overlooks them. To him, it's free labor. There's people there that are cleaning up after him. Many people would love to have it. I would have loved to have that growing up. I mean, Absalom and his men come in and order pizza, leave boxes all over the place, and they just clean it up. I mean, every day they're just cleaning up the house, keeping the house, making sure that everything is spick and span, because they know that one day David's going to come back home. And they're going to make sure that they have it right, that everything is exactly how David wants it.
My God.
Then Absalom finds out where David is, and he goes out after him. And it isn't long before they receive word that Absalom's dead, that David is returning home.
Yeah.
But you see, something happened in between that.
Right.
Something happened that was we read in chapter 16. One day they're just walking around. They're just in the house working when they're grabbed by servants and they're dragged to a rooftop where Absalom takes them and he defiles them on a roof. In front of everybody, in front of all Israel. You know, you see, in that time, whenever a woman was defiled, they were viewed as worthless. They lost all value to anybody.
That's right.
You see, these women did not choose to be a part of this plan.
Right.
But they were taken up and they were defiled by Absalom, just as a power play. He then throws them and he makes them go right back to work. And that's exactly what they do. They go right back to keeping the house. Absalom leaves. They find out he's dead. And they find out David's coming home. You know, they had to be excited because, you know, here they'd went through so much. They had done everything David had said to.
Yeah.
Absalom came in and defiled them and just ruined their lives. But David, their love was coming home. He was going to redeem them. Everything was going to be fine when David comes home. Only, you know, they go and they stand and they see him coming afar off. They get excited. They see David coming. Everything is perfect. Finally, he's coming home. They can see him. They've made eye contact, and he shows up. He walks onto the porch, and he doesn't even embrace them.
Oh, no.
He just walks right by them. I'm sure at first they had to wonder what's going on.
Sure.
Why didn't he embrace us? We haven't seen him in months. What's going on? And he has the servants grab them and take them in, and he feeds them one last meal. And then he takes them into the middle of the house and imprisons them for the rest of their lives. That moment of joy, that turned to a moment of grief because they had to realize what was going on.
All right.
They realized that they were now worthless in the eyes of David. I'm sure they had to cry out and say, David, wait a minute.
Jesus.
You left us. We did exactly what you told us to do. We were faithful to you. They said, you left us. Absalom defiled us. What have we done wrong? What did they do to deserve to live in widowhood for the rest of their lives? Nothing. They did absolutely nothing to deserve it. But life just dealt them an unfair hand that left them living in widowhood for the rest of their lives.
Jesus.
So what do you do when you find yourself living in widowhood? How do we deal with something like that? You know, perhaps it is a bad marriage. You look at the divorce rate in the world, and my wife, she grew up in a broken home. Her mother left her when she was 2 years old. That's something you just don't recover from.
Right.
It's something you have to figure out how to deal with and how to move on. But you look around, and you try to find reasons, and you try to figure out, how did I deserve this? What did I do to bring this upon my life?
Right.
When all the while, we didn't do anything. But we find ourselves living in widowhood. Maybe some of you have had to deal with a cheating spouse or had to face divorce itself.
Yeah.
Or you were the product of a broken home.
Jeez.
Things that you can't undo. Mistakes that can't be undone.
Yeah.
But we have to figure out how to get past that.
Yes.
Maybe you find yourself at a job that you hate. And I've been there. I've worked jobs that, oh my goodness. I prayed every day, God, may open a door. I'll feed the pigs and eat with them, just whatever I got to do to get out of this situation.
Yes, sir.
You know, but sometimes we find ourselves in those situations for a reason.
That's right.
Reasons that we definitely don't see while we're there.
That's the truth.
But we look back years later and we see everything that God teaches us and everything that he brought us from.
All right.
Amen.
But you see, when you find yourself in that situation, you can understand the widows.
My.
Sometimes people die in our families. People, and you see it all the time. People dying younger and younger from just crazy situations. But how do you cope with something like that? Because it's so easy to point fingers and try to come up with every reason imaginable and say, well, God, I they didn't deserve to die. God, why would you take them? You know, I could come up with a list of other people you should have took before them. But we can't figure out why God always works like that. You know, and very few people can say that they are what they wanted to be when they were growing up.
Yeah, sure.
People go through life and they find themselves at 30, 40, 50, 60, and having not having accomplished anything that they wanted to when they were coming up through high school. All the things they dreamed of being. And all of a sudden you wake up one day and realize, how did I get here?
Right.
But you see, life happens. Yeah. We have situations and circumstances that we come against every single day that change the course of our life.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That change the direction and sometimes can change the whole outcome of where we end up one day.
Yeah, that's right.
You see, many of us have every right in the world to be bitter about something. If we begin to look back and we wouldn't even have to look very deep or very far to find things that have happened to us personally that we could choose to be bitter about.
Sure, absolutely.
But the question is, do you choose it? Because you have every right to be.
Right.
You have every right to be bitter for the things that have happened in your life. But do you choose it? Because you see, the widows could have. The widows could have choose to be bitter.
Yes, sir.
Elijah had to help a widow deal with her bitterness.
Yes.
1 Kings 17 says, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, arise, get thee to Zarephath, which belongeth to Zion, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee. So he arose and he went to Zarephath. Now here, you know, there's a drought that's been going on for quite some time. Elijah's been being fed by birds and drinking from a brook.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And all of a sudden the brook dries up and the birds stop coming. Uh-huh. And God comes and tells Elijah, he says, all right, I got you a widow ready that's going to take care of you for the rest of this drought.
Yeah.
If I'm Elijah, I get excited because I've been eating bird food and drinking from a little creek for God knows how long.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, the Lord tells him that there's a widow that's going to take care of him for the rest of this drought. Now, he's got to, you got to know, this is not a very wealthy place. This is a bad drought. So if somebody's going to be able to take care of him and sustain him for years, they got to be pretty wealthy. They got to be doing pretty well off.
Yeah.
And so that... If I'm Elijah, that's my first thought is, man, God's got me a rich widow waiting. She's going to have me, you know, just cakes and just bread everywhere. And just the fatted calves going to be killed as soon as I walk in the door.
Yeah.
You know, and so he's just skipping to Zarephath, just as happy as a lark, buddy. Just running down there, and he's just waiting. Everything is going to get better right now. As soon as he walks through the gates, it's going to be like pearly gates, if you will, just waiting for him. Everything is going to be set. Everything is going to be ready. And he walks through, and he sees a woman picking up sticks, and his first thought is, there's a servant picking up sticks, getting ready to bake me some bread. And so he tells her to go fetch him some water. And the lady, she goes and gets some water, and he says, bring me a cake. He said, I'm hungry. You know, he's thinking everything's about to change right here. And that lady turned around, and she looked at him, and she said, I've only got enough for me and my son. She said, I'm picking up these two sticks. I'm going to go make two cakes, one for me, one for my son. We're going to eat them, and we're going to die. And you can just see all the blood drain from Elijah's face.
My.
As he says, wait a minute. What did I just walk into?
Right.
He was expecting a rich widow when he found a suicidal one in her place.
Yeah.
And says, what, God? You know, what just happened here? This is not the widow I was expecting. This is not the widow I was looking for.
Come on now. Yeah.
You see, because this widow, she says, as the Lord thy God liveth. She says, thy God. She had gotten so bitter, and she had been through so much, that she says, you know, he might be your God. But I don't see it anymore. She had watched her husband die. She had lost everything she had. She was to the point where she was fixing to have to watch her son die before she died herself. And what did she do to deserve this? You see, Elijah, all this drought was something between Elijah and the queen. She was just a side effect, but her husband was no longer in the picture. She was fixing to die herself, and she had gotten so bitter that she didn't even claim God to be her own anymore.
My Lord.
But what was so unique is that she still allowed God to use her.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Because she said, what do I got to lose?
Right.
He said, go make me one first. And she did. She
That's
said,
right.
Well,
That's good.
I'm going to die. I'm going to die whether I do or whether I don't.
Yes, sir.
Right.
Yes, sir.
What do I got to lose?
Come on.
Amen.
And so she went and she made the cake. And we know the story. God, he provided a way.
Ooh, yes.
The oil never ran out. The meal never ran out. And they began to eat 3 meals a day, every single day. Where God kept providing a way and providing a way. Because he let a widow use her.
Amen.
There was a widow that just said, you know, just I'll give it a try. I'll give it a shot to try something different.
Yes, sir.
But you continue that story, and you don't even have to go very far.
Mama.
That her son dies.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
And as soon as he does, you see that bitterness come straight back up again.
Mama.
And she goes and she points her finger in the man of God's face, and she says, this is your fault.
Jesus.
She said, have you brought this reproach on me because of my sin, because of my past?
Jesus.
She said, are you here to remind me of what I've done in my past? And she blames the man of God. And it says that Elijah took the child and brought him down out of the chamber into the house and delivered him unto his mother. And Elijah said, see, thy son liveth. You see, Elijah took her son. He took him in there. He restored him. He brought him back to life because God said, I'm not going to let him go. And he brought her back and he placed her in the hands of the mother. And this is what amazes me. She said, then the woman said to Elijah, now by this I know that thou art a man of God. And that the word of the Lord is in thy mouth is truth.
My.
It took her son dying and coming back to life before she ever acknowledged that he was a man of God.
My Lord.
And that the word of his mouth is truth.
That's right.
That there is still a God.
Right.
You see, that blows my mind because we don't know how long was in between from when they started to her son dying. It could have possibly been 2 years.
Yeah.
That they had been eating bread every day. Three times a day.
Right.
Every day she would walk in there and get the oil and pour it and get the meal and she just, you know, she'd start whipping up bread. Maybe that's where Miracle Whip came from. She was just whipping up miracles every single day. You know, but every day she's out there whipping these miracles out that they ate them. They ate miracles every single day, three times a day.
Right.
And she still couldn't see that God was in it.
Come on.
That's right.
You see, the reason is because when we live in widowhood, and we allow bitterness to creep into us, it clouds our vision and our judgment.
Come on now.
We don't see things clearly. We begin to look at things a little distorted. We don't see things quite like we should.
Yes, sir.
Because as soon as she acknowledged that God is God, and she allowed that bitterness to leave her, all of a sudden she could see clearly. All of a sudden she said, now I can see you're the man of God. Now I can see your words are truth. Now I can see that God has been moving in this thing the whole time.
Yeah.
But you see, as we stay, when we stay in widowhood, we'll stay skeptical of people because we feel like the whole world is against us. We feel like everybody's against us and that nobody is for us. Doesn't matter what you do or where you go. We come into the church and somebody gets up and preaches something mean and we just say, oh, they're preaching to me. They're against me. They're preaching right at me. That's not it at all. You got to get your vision right. You got to get some bitterness out of the way, some anger out of the way, and not let some help come in. Let the words of the man of God be truth in your life. You see, we have to get past the bitterness of widowhood and allow God to use us. Because God still uses widows. God is still looking for widows. And you don't have to be ashamed of living in widowhood. But you need to realize that God loves widows and has provided a way out for widows. Isaiah 54 and verse 4 says, fear not. For thou shalt not be ashamed, neither be thou confounded. For thou shalt not be put to shame. For thou shalt forget the shame of thy youth, and shalt not remember the reproach of thy widowhood anymore. For thy Maker is thine husband. The Lord of hosts is his name. And the Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, the God of the whole earth shall he be called. Isaiah said, you don't have to be afraid or ashamed or confounded. He lets us know that we're not going to be put to shame because of our past. Because of our widowhood. Because of whatever it is that we have in our past.
Yeah.
All the bitterness, the anger, anything that's happened, we don't have to be ashamed of it. Because we can come and we have a Maker that is ready to join with us, to be part of us.
Right.
It says that our Maker, our husband, our other half, he will make us whole. It says that our Redeemer wants to redeem us.
Yes.
He's the God of the whole earth. You see, he wants to give us purpose again.
Yeah.
And what makes us so awesome is that God tells us all through the Bible that he will never leave us nor forsake us.
That's right.
That's right. That's
Right. God said, if you will come to me, you will let me take your reproach. You let me redeem you. He said, I will be your husband. I, the maker of the whole universe, will become one with you. And you no longer have to live under that shame. And I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. But we have to cleave to God. And we have to build a relationship with him. And we no longer have to live our lives out living in widowhood. You can let go of the bitterness, the fear, the doubt, the anger, the jealousy, the hatred, envy, and strife. You can let it all go. Let go of your past. You can start all over. See, God is not in the shaming business. He is not wanting to shame you for what you've done, for where you've been. None of that matters when we step into that relationship with God. It's all water under the bridge. If we give him the pieces and give him our shame, you see, he'll give us his name. He'll make something beautiful out of us. You see, but for us to take him as our husband, it requires us to take his name.
Yeah, that's right.
For us to take him as our husband, the maker as our husband, we have to take his name. We have to have his name applied.
Yeah.
Because if you don't, you need to get connected to the name today.
Yeah.
You say, well, how do I take the name? How do I take the name of Jesus? How do I become one with God? Well, Acts 2:38 tells us exactly how to do that. Through repentance, which is, let me just stop. Repentance is not just coming and saying, forgive me, and walking away and going right back to
that's
it.
Right.
Yeah.
You see, repentance is one of those things that a lot of people pass over. It's something that's quickly passed over. We go right to baptism.
Right.
But repentance is just as required and just as necessary as the other two steps.
Yeah. Yeah.
Repentance is just as necessary. But repentance is making a 180. It's when you come and you lay some stuff on an altar. And you walk away and you never go back to it again. So when you lay it down and say, God, there's some things I've struggled in this place, in this area, in this situation. You have to be specific with God. God wants us to be specific to say, God, I've struggled with this. I've dealt with this. I ran into this. And God, right now, I want to lay it all under the blood. I want to start a new life. I don't want to go back to this anymore. I have a new life I want to live. I have a new direction, a new course that I've chosen for my life. After we make it through repentance, and after we stand up, leaving so much on that altar, we find ourselves leading to the water. And we go and we're baptized in the name of Jesus because the power is in the name. You see, right here is where we take the name. This is where we take the name of Jesus and we become one with our Maker. And when we come up out of that water, he gives us a wedding gift. He gives us a gift of the Holy Ghost. The bridegroom brings us a gift. Our Lord Christ, he came on this earth. He lived here 33 years, a sinless life. He died to send one gift. I was talking to a young man probably a few months ago, a guy I went to high school with, hadn't talked to in years, and he called me out of the blue and said he wanted to know more about the plan of salvation. He said somebody he had heard about it a little bit and went to a Pentecostal church. And he said, I didn't know who to call, and then I remembered you. He said, I remember you telling me this stuff. And I began to give him a Bible study and talk to him about it. And he said, okay, I understand repentance. And I understand baptism in Jesus' name. He said, but do I have to get the Holy Ghost? And I said, Jacob, you're thinking about it all wrong, buddy. I said, it's not about having to. It's that you get to. I said, it's the only gift that God ever sent me. I said, I don't know about you. I said, but I like gifts. I said, Jacob, if you want to send me a gift every day for the rest of your life, I'll take it. I said, I like gifts. I said, now if God went through everything that he went through to send back one gift, why would you not want it?
Yeah.
I said, don't think about something. It's not something we have to. It's something we get to.
Yeah.
It's something we get to enjoy. It is a blessing, a gift that I want. If I get to heaven, if I know it's not required, I'm not worried about it because I got to enjoy it. It was something that I got to walk in, something I got to enjoy. It is a blessing. It is amazing. It is something that will change your life forever. But you see, taking the name is so important because without the name, we're not truly one with Jesus.
That's right.
You see, when my wife and I got married, she took my last name. Her name was Bethany Briscoe, and she became Bethany Miller. But just taking the name isn't enough. You see, if you go and you're baptized and you get filled with the Holy Ghost and then you never talk to God again, that's not enough. That relationship doesn't last.
Come on.
If I married my wife and then that was, you know, and I just talked, or maybe if I just talked to her once a week, that relationship wouldn't last very long.
No, it wouldn't.
You might think that's what happened right now because she's not with me. But that's not the case, I promise. I talked to her on the way here and I'll talk to her on the way home. But you see, it's the same way with God. When we enter into that relationship, it's just like a marriage. God says, I want to hear from you. I want to talk to you every single day.
Yes.
You see, and what? But it's more than just talking. You got to listen.
Yes, sir.
We got to slow down sometimes and take just a few minutes out of our busy lives and just listen to God, because God wants to speak to us.
Yes, he does.
He tries to speak into our lives. Amen. But you see, God loves widows, and he's always looking for widows to bless and to pour his spirit into, for those to take his name. You see, because when we become one with God, he shares our burdens.
Yes, he does.
He shares our pain, because we become one with him. Yes. And we have to communicate every single day. We have to be willing to give of ourselves and work together with God.
Right,
Mark 12 and 41, you read about the widow that came and she gave her 2 pence.
Right.
There was a widow that God, he stopped everything and said, look at this widow.
Right.
You see this widow? She is special because she gave her all.
Amen.
God is looking for people that will say, God, I want to give my all. God, I realize I don't have much to give. I'm nothing special, God, but I want to give you everything.
Yes.
And God said, He said, this woman will be blessed abundantly above all else, that all the other people that had given because of what she'd done. And it was just because she was willing to give her all. God says, hey, it's not about the amount you bring to me. It's not about the quantity, it's about the quality.
Yes.
It's about what you're willing to bring to me. He just wants everything.
Yes.
Doesn't matter how much, just what little bit we have. God says, if you'll bring it to me, I'll take it.
Yes.
So what now? And when we've taken his name and we've given him our all, we have to realize that there will come a time in our lives, even after doing both of those things, when it seems as though God has shut us up living in widowhood.
Sure.
When life just hits us right between the eyes, and we'll wonder why God hasn't come through for us. We'll question his motives. We'll question his power.
Jesus.
We'll feel cheated or maybe even shamed. But in those times, you have to remember the widow that was closest to Jesus. Mary, his mother. We know that Joseph died sometime when Jesus was still fairly young. You have to know that Mary begged Jesus to heal her father, to heal Joseph. Begged Jesus, said, Jesus, you can do this. I know you have the power. You are the Son of God. All you have to do is speak it. And Jesus said, I can't. He said, I can't, Mary. It's not time. It's not my time. And Jesus himself had to watch his own dad die. He had to watch his mother suffer for the rest of her life, living in widowhood. But why? Why didn't he heal his father? You see, Jesus said it wasn't time. But he was willing to suffer the death of his father for the sake of his plans. He was willing to suffer the death of his father and the pain that his mother had to endure for the greater plans. You see, it's no wonder he had such compassion for widows. No wonder he loves widows so much he lived with one. And on the day of his death, the main thing he was concerned with was making sure that that widow was taken care of. He said, John, see your mother.
That's right.
Mother, see your son. He made sure that widow was taken care of. Listen to me tonight. God cares for each and every one of us. Mm-hmm. He cares about our problems. He cares about our prayers. But sometimes his plans are greater than the pain that we experience to see them through.
Yes. That's good.
Sometimes things happen in our lives, and it's for the greater plan that we can't even explain.
Yes,
but you see, we as born-again children of God, we have to be okay with that.
Yes.
We have to be willing to be spent.
Right.
Yes.
Just like Stephen was spent by Paul.
Yes.
Sometimes we have to go through things that we don't understand. Things that people would just say, well, that's just life. That's just how it happens. But sometimes it's for a reason that we may never see. Reasons that may happen generations from now.
Sure.
But God has a greater plan, and we have to be willing to be okay with that.
Yes.
To say, God, I still trust you.
God,
I still love you.
Amen.
God, I'm not going to get bitter for all these things that have happened to me and all these things that have happened in my life. We have to trust that the Lord is good and that his thoughts are higher than our own.
Amen.
And we have to hope in a greater purpose. And if we'll do that, we'll have the possibility of a story like Ruth's. Because you see, Ruth could have gotten bitter. She came back with her mother-in-law, Naomi, And Naomi came back and she said, call me Mara, for the Lord has dealt with me bitterly. She came back bitter because her husband had died. Her sons had died. But you see, Ruth never let that bitterness get into her. She went and she found Boaz, and Boaz redeemed her. And Boaz and her, the story goes that they had a son, Obed. And Naomi came out of her bitterness. She received joy. She came out of her bitterness through Ruth, through her grandchild.
That's right.
Sometimes when we get bitter, we need to find somebody like Ruth to hook ourselves to.
Yes.
Somebody that's not bitter, because it's so easy to come into a place and find somebody that's just like you to hook yourself to.
That's right.
It's so easy to find somebody that's just as bitter as you are, that wants to, that you can go and you can talk to and just swap stories and talk about why you're bitter and how bitter you are. But if you do something like Naomi did and find somebody that won't, that refuses to get bitter, find a Ruth and hook your life to him. You can find that God can still bring you out of widowhood. That you can let go of all that bitterness, and come out of widowhood.
Yes.
In closing, if the musicians want to come. The story goes that Boaz, he took Ruth to wife, and they bear a son, Obed. And like I said, Naomi lives out her life in God's blessings, over, taking care of her grandson. But then Obed was the father of Jesse, who was the father of King David. But you know who Boaz's mom was? Rahab the harlot. So God took the son of a Gentile harlot.
Yeah.
And the son of a widow, of a Moabite widow.
That's right.
Who refused to be bitter. And he produced a lineage that would not only produce the King of Israel, but the King of Glory himself, Jesus Christ.
Yes, sir.
Because a couple widows, I said, I'm not going to get bitter. I refuse to be bitter. See, every one of us have had things happen in our lives that we didn't see coming. Things that weren't our fault. Things that we didn't want to be a part of. Things just called life. But if Ruth had not been a widow, we never would have had a King David. You see, it was part of the plan.
Yes, sir.
It was all part of the plan for Ruth to go through widowhood, to have to live in widowhood for a season. But when God brought her out, he redeemed her and he gave her something more valuable and more special than she ever would have had before ever living in widowhood. As you stand tonight, see, we serve a God tonight that loves each and every one of us more than we could ever think of loving anyone on this earth. A God who is calling us out of widowhood. If you've become bitter, you need to hook yourself to a Ruth. Hook yourself to somebody that sees hope, that says, I refuse to be bitter. I refuse to live in widowhood. Give Jesus your shame and he will give you his name.
Yes.
He will be beautiful in the end. Tonight I open these altars to widows. I open these altars to people that are seeking to be one with Jesus. Maybe some of you have anger that you want to let go of. Or maybe you just want to give God complete control of your life. See, God is not looking to pin any of us to shame. That's not his reason for being here. He's not here to give us shame or to push shame on us. But God wants us to come and take his name through baptism, to live a life with him, to become one with him. But once again, the choice is yours. What will you choose?
Yeah.
Will you continue to live in widowhood?
Come on now.
Or will you come out? Will you let Jesus have complete control? Will you give him all? Will you give him everything tonight? If it's all right, I know it's a Wednesday night. But why don't we all just come to the front and find a place to just talk to God?